Welcome to the Innovation and Technology Management Seminar Series hosted by the Engineering Management Program in the Pratt School of Engineering at Duke University. My name is Jeff Glass and I'm the Faculty Director for the Engineering Management Program. The purpose of our seminar series is to introduce engineers and scientists to various business and management concepts that they will find useful throughout their careers. Speakers represent a diverse array of industries from finance and information technology to materials processing and biotechnology. If you'd like to learn more about the Engineering Management Program at Duke, including these podcasts and any associated audiovisual materials that are sometimes available, please visit our website at memp.duke.edu. Thanks for your interest in our series, and please do not hesitate to contact us with suggestions or questions.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I was here, like she said, 2 years ago, and I really enjoyed it. Had a great time, and I really appreciate getting my secondary education. Okay, so today I'm really going to talk to you about my career journey with engineering as my foundation. And it's probably not a typical engineering journey, but it could be yours. You know, it's, in other words, the main message of this talk is that your life changes as time goes on. You have different passions and different interests, and your career could take on the same type of shifts. And mine certainly did, and I'm still, you know, I just shifted, 9 months ago? In last June, I started a new career in Smart Grid, but I will walk you through it step by step. And also, this is very informal, so anytime you have a question, just ask, and, you know, there's nothing formal about this. Started off, like I said, chemical engineering from NC State University. I loved chemistry in high school, and that's mainly because I had this wonderful teacher who really taught us chemistry in a visual way. So I was able to visualize the atoms and the molecules and the bonds, and that's how I related to chemistry, and I loved it. Took advanced chemistry in high school and definitely was, you know, already excited about chemical engineering. However, I graduated 4 years later, and you know how the companies come to your school and you interview for jobs? Well, I ended up having 4 different offers, but there was a catch there. All of these jobs required me wearing a hard hat, and that just was not my vision of what I was going to do after 4 years of suffering through school, wearing blue jeans and tennis shoes. I saw myself fixing my hair up, wearing high heels or boots, and looking all pretty at work and not putting a hard hat. So, you know, I had to say no to all of that and decided to go straight to graduate school. I'm not ready for the real world. So I went on and got a master's degree in electrical engineering. Now, my first job out of school was hardware design. And it was a company called Memorex Telex. I don't think it's around anymore. But I remember having this job, it was less than a year actually, and halfway through it, this was in the early 1980s, like around 1985, the term layoff was rather new. No one really knew what a layoff was. We didn't really experience it as a society that much, but that's when it all got started. And all of a sudden, 6 months into the job, my company had layoffs, and my cube mate, Doug, was around 40 years old. And remember, I was 23, you know, probably your age or 22. And I remember when he got laid off, I got so scared and so nervous and started crying and going to my manager and saying, "You cannot lay Doug off. He's an old man. I mean, he's 40 years old. He has children. How could you lay off someone like that? Please take me. I'm still young. I can get a job easily. Don't lay off, you know, Doug." And everyone thought it was hilarious that I'm acting this way, but I, you know, I thought it was a very serious situation, and I felt really, really bad. So then about 6 months later, they had a second layoff, and of course, I was laid off. Okay, I deserve that. But I was actually pretty excited about the layoff because it gives me an opportunity to now go and find a new path for myself, and I wanted to find out what really interested me. And I remember sitting around reading the newspaper, the News and Observer, because I live in Raleigh, and I read about this company called Square D that was getting into optics, and it was doing something really unique with sensors and optics. And I remembered in graduate school I did this one project on laser technology, I mean, now laser seems the norm here, but in the 80s, this was kind of a new technology. So I got really excited, like, oh, optics and, you know, lasers and photoelectric sensors. So this company was called Square D. So they didn't have any job openings or anything, but that's what I wanted to work in. And it was, I knew it was a new part of this company. And so I called the company Square D, and I said, hi, can I please speak to the director of engineering? And they said, why? And I said, well, I'm just interested to hear more about, you know, what you do in, with these sensors and photoelectric. And the lady who answered the phone said, okay, well, I'll switch you over to human resources. So she sent me human resources, and I hang up because I never talk to human resources. I hope no one in here is associated with human resources. I always bypass them. So so then I called again, and I said, well, could I speak to someone about photoelectric sensors? Forget the whole director of engineering. And the same lady answered, and she's like, well, I'll have to send you to human resources. I'm like, well, shoot, how do I get past this? And I'm not an advocate of lying at all, but white lies I am, especially if they harm no one. So I figured out this little white lie, that I could call the company and pretend like I was speaking to the director of engineering and that I really wanted to write him a thank you note, and I didn't know how to spell his last name. So now I'm calling the same lady. Of course, I'm changing my voice because I just called, you know, 10,000 times. And she keeps sending me to human resources. So I call and I say, you know, I was just speaking to this director of engineering and I just want to send him a thank you. Can you spell his last name? And she said, Smith. And I'm like, yes, well, you never know. It could be a Y. That is going to be some Polish last name or something that's very difficult. But anyway, so I got this guy's name. So now I wait about a half an hour. I call that same lady again. I mean, she sits in the front and she answers all calls going to Square D. She answers the phone and I was like, yes, can I please speak to Mr. Smith? And I, boom, I go straight to him. So this is great. I'm talking on the phone to him. I am looking for a job, excuse me. I am looking for a job, but I don't tell him I'm looking for a job. I'm just interested in having a conversation. So I said, hi, you know, my name is such and such, and I read an article in the paper about photoelectric sensors, and, you know, tell me a little bit about this. So he's talking to me, and I'm inserting a little bit of my background, you know, during the conversation, and things are going pretty well, and I get kind of brave, and I say, well, would you have about 5 minutes to meet me for a cup of coffee? And he said, no. And I was like, okay. So I pushed my limits a little bit too far. But what I did at this point is, remember, in the 1985, this is before the internet, it's before emails, so everything was handwritten or typed up and through snail mail. So I lived about 45 minutes away from the company. I used word processor at the time. That was just invented. And I wrote a letter saying, you know, thank you so much for your time, da-da-da-da-da-da, I really appreciate it. And by the way, I'm enclosing my resume just in case, you know, you find that there might be an interest for us to meet. And put this in a letter, drove all the way out to Square D, went to the guard station, and said, excuse me, sir, could you deliver this one letter to this person, Mr. Smith, in the next half hour? So again, it's only been like 45 minutes to an hour since I got off the phone. And now I'm saying, can you deliver this in the next half hour? And he said, yes. So he delivered it. And I waited, waited, nothing happened. The next day, I get a call from another manager at Square D that happened to be looking for people working on photoelectric sensors and was given my resume by the director of engineering. So imagine that. You know, the director of engineering has given my resume to a manager that is actually looking to hire someone. And so I came in for an interview, and 2 days later, I had the job. So the reason why I want to share that story is because there's all types of ways to go out and find your job. Don't just look in the want ads, or I don't think you call them the want ads, or monster.com, or any of those places. Go and find your passion, find the area you want to work in, and kind of bother those people until you get what you want. So that was my first job, and that's and also my second job. And then I'll tell you a little short story about how I worked in hardware design. You know, so I was designing photoelectric sensors, and I loved my job. I love this work passionately. However, there was one night where I actually had to work late and by myself in the laboratory because I needed the oscilloscope, and I needed the ohm meter, I needed everything, which I don't have at home. So I had to stay there, and I get scared, to be honest with you. I'm one of those scaredy scat. And I get scared being by myself at night when all the lights are off all around me. But the lab was lit up. So I finished up around midnight. I walk outside the lab, and there's this hallway that has like one of those red exit signs in it. And I have to go through this hallway to get to the double doors, which goes to the atrium, which takes me to the parking lot where I can get in my car. So I'm walking through this hallway with this red hue, and I'm already scared. And the minute I open the doors to walk out to the atrium, a huge, tall guy is walking in at the exact same moment. So, of course, I scream bloody murder, like, ah! And my scream causes him to scream because he got scared. And so he's, like, screaming. And I'm screaming, and we're both screaming back and forth for about 10 minutes, like crazy. And then the next thing you know, we're both like calming down. I was like, I'm so sorry, I was here to work on the lab. And he goes, I'm so sorry, I'm here to clean up these offices. And I'm like, oh my God, I was so scared. He goes, I was so scared. So, but anyway, that whole episode, as it was, as simple as that was a whole career shift for me. Because I vowed at that point, I'm not going to do a job that makes me, like if I have to work overtime, which we all have to at some point, that I'll have to be by myself and, you know, at night in a laboratory. So, at the time, hardware engineering was sort of getting reduced and software engineering was sort of increasing. And I said, well, software engineering is something that you can do at home. You just need a computer and you need, well, the internet didn't exist at the time, but you need a computer. And that I could buy and have at my house. So, because of that one incident, I actually shifted my whole career from hardware design to now software design. So, you can see, and that's a huge shift, and people said, there's no way. I mean, my husband graduated from computer science at State, right, you know, alongside with me. And I said, you know, Tony, I think I'm going to do software. He's like, you can't do software. Like, he got a chemical engineering degree, he had one Fortran class, and that's it. And you're going to get these naysayers. I think we talked about that. And I'm like, well, you just watch me. And, you know, I interviewed for these positions. I said, I can learn this stuff fast. Just, you know, tell me which language you're writing in, and I'll do it. And I ended up with 4 offers in software. So I was like, ha, you know, to my husband. He didn't think I could do it. And so then my career shifted to software, even though I had a chemical engineering and a master's in electrical. So that's, you know, then I kept going in software. I got more into data communications, and then I got into these bleeding edge data communications. So at one point it was the OSI stack, that OSI software, they're going to do the whole management and the whole email. Everything was going to be OSI stack, and that became too complicated, so it died. Then I went into something called ATM, not the ATM machines, but the asynchronous transfer mode, which, of course, at IBM you were working in. And then that didn't go anywhere because we had a whole startup company that was working on ATM for the LAN and it was competing with Ethernet. But as we know, Ethernet won. So that died down. And then my next job, I just stayed with a team. We were this team that did a startup. And the whole team interviewed for this other startup. And we all stayed together and now is working in DSL, which was really very exciting. So that was about 17 years worth of all types of career shifts, but always something that I'm very excited about, something that I'm very interested and passionate. And it's funny how your passion just really changed alongside your career. I think that's one of the most important things about a career is passion. At some point, I was like, you know, I've been doing all this bleeding edge technology, and I really want to even go further into bleeding edge. Because what I really want to do is academic research. So again, I had a lot of naysayers. Said I want to. I went to a professor at State University, Dr. Perros. He's in computer science, and I said, you know what? I want to get my PhD, and I want to pay my mortgage. So I'm looking for a job that will pay me while I do my research that I will publish to get my PhD. And he's like, you cannot do it. You have to decide. Either you're going to do your PhD, or you're going to work a job and get a good salary. I said, I want to do both. And so I took him to lunch that day to talk about this, and obviously it didn't get through to him. So I said, well, how about if we go to lunch again? And this time I took him to an expensive restaurant. I think that's the trick. And I said, look, Dr. Pierce, I know there's a way to do this, and you have to help me do it. Just listen to me. I would really have to get a job and that does research. I know we can come up with something together. And sure enough, he did. He said, well, you know, at MCNC, it's a nonprofit research organization here in the park. It doesn't do research anymore, by the way, but at that time it did. And again, they didn't have a job opening. And I met with a guy and I said, look, I really want to do this. I want to get into optical communications. I know that's what you're working in. And I didn't, you know, I didn't really stand a chance with this because I've never done academic research. I've only published one journal paper just because I was asked to do it when I was working in DSL. And, you know, I don't have a PhD, so why would this guy hire me? Well, it turns out I had to do a research paper for him. I even suggested that. I said, what if I write a portion of the research paper? You're looking for network management? And he wants to get into the whole network management thing, and so I did that. I didn't have a job. I didn't have a promise of a job. I probably spent, you know, a good 40 hours putting together, or probably more, maybe 2 weeks working on this paper, off hours from my regular job. And lo and behold, I got a job offer. And I worked there for about 10 years doing academic research, which I loved. I did everything that I wanted to do. I published papers. I published a book. I traveled the world. I collaborated with people in Japan and China and all the European countries. I really did everything that I really wanted to do with this job. And at some point, MCNC decided not to do research anymore, but do more of the networking for K-12 in the universities. And that just didn't match up with my thing. And so this was another opportunity to do yet another shift. So I did this for about 10 years. So the first part of my career was about 17 years in industry, this academic research. And then I decided to start a handbag company. And the reason why I started a handbag company is because traveling around the world, giving talks, I always wanted to carry a bag that I can put my computer in, my documents in. And then usually, no matter which city I'm in, if I'm in London or Dubai, I want to go to dinner with all my colleagues. And they're usually guys, and so they can just carry their little briefcase and put it down. I had a backpack, an ugly old black leather backpack. And, you know, you're walking into these fancy restaurants with this backpack just did not feel right. I was like, so I spent about 3 years looking for the perfect handbag that kind of looks fashionable and cool, but, you know, also very functional. Could not find what I wanted, so I started my own handbag company. And I did it part-time, so I stopped working at MCNC and did my research at NC State as a research scientist while building this company. And then I spent 1 year just focused on this company. I really enjoyed it. I used my engineering there. I had to do the design of all the patterns. I had to look at all the materials. I created a new material by taking linen and using a polyvinyl chloride coating for the inside of the bag so that you can wipe it clean when it gets dirty. So everything was very functional, but I used my chemical engineering, I used, you know, mechanical engineering, I used computer science, but I had to do marketing, I had to do sales, I had to do accounting, I had to finance, you know, everything. And that was such a great experience. What I did learn is I probably can't get my two daughters through college on that salary. It's not enough. I'm not that good at sales. I did sell a lot of bags, and I'm still selling it. So I never stopped doing my company. But in order for me to think about getting my kids through college, I need to go back to my normal salary type. And then I said, well, what am I interested in? I mean, what could beat the fashion industry? You know, I mean, this has been such a fun ride. I'm in magazines, I'm getting interviewed, I'm getting to show my stuff at big shows, you know. That's just so fun compared to engineering, even though it is a lot of engineering underneath it. And then all of a sudden, I was on this mailing list. It was called the Triangle Clean Tech Mailing List, and I got this email one time with a white paper about water, and water as a global resource, and how this... is going to become a crisis in the next 3 years. In the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to be in crisis mode globally with our fresh water, clean water to drink. And I was like, oh, that is so interesting. So then, of course, I get obsessed with things. And I got 4 books off of Amazon and started reading everything there is to read about global water and the crisis coming. I watched every Netflix, documentary on water. And to the point where my kids and my family was like, Mom, please, you cannot bring up water in every conversation. But you sort of can. Like, everything has something to do with water. And unfortunately, that's what I did, and I pissed off my family a little bit. But I did get really excited. And I sort of got ahead of myself. But anyway, so just keep that thought about getting involved in water. I did want to say that when I had all these changes in careers, there were a lot of things that were different about them. But one thing, or 4 things that stayed the same, is my approaches to these jobs. So the approach always included risk-taking. It always included cross-pollination, because whatever I came from gives me a different perspective than the people already in it. So if I'm going into software and I don't have a whole career or even an education in software, it's kind of amazing how you can bring something different to the table because you don't have that training. So that's cross-pollination, then there's collaboration, and then there's research. So risk, always believe in taking risk. In fact, we were talking about that earlier. Failures are wonderful things to experience, because it's only through failures do you learn the most. And I talk to my kids all the time about, what have you failed at lately, so I could be so proud of you, because really failures are just as important, if not more important, than some of our successes. So I've learned so much. I love this quote. For you who love so many quotes, I love this one. I've learned so much from my mistakes. I'm thinking of making a few more. And I do believe that throughout my life, but it also has a lot to do with my whole career. Cross-pollination, as I just said, even, bringing my chemical engineering background into handbags, bringing engineering into handbags, all that made for my handbags kind of look very different than what's on the market today. So you can always cross-pollinate from different industries. Collaboration. It's a really bad picture, but this is a large hadron collider in Geneva, Switzerland. So I worked quite a bit on that when I was doing my research on optical communications, because this project required 7,000 scientists and engineers working together. So can you imagine that? This thing would not have been built if it wasn't for 7,000 scientists and engineers collaborating. So I do believe collaboration is one of the most important things in anything that you do, any type of career, anywhere you go. Collaboration, collaboration, collaboration. Just working with people brings different perspectives, and when you have the same goals but you have different perspectives, the solution is always richer and better and more exciting. This is one of my favorite words of all time. And then research. Everything requires lots of research, and boy, thank God for Google. I always tell my kids, I just can't imagine school if I had to go through school again without Google now. But that's what I did. I mean, I went through school without Google. When I worked at Square D and we were doing photoelectric sensors, the first thing I did is I went to the NC State Library and spent hours and hours researching on microfilm. And I mean, life was just so different now. Now you can Google anything, and I love it. So research the heck out of everything. Look at all different perspectives, all different ways to look at the same problem space. Which got me to this. So as I'm researching and as I found out a little bit about this water crisis, I learned a lot. Like, worldwide, the demand for energy and water is increasing while costs are rising everywhere. I mean, we should be feeling it here in the Raleigh-Durham, Chapel Hill area. We're growing tremendously. And our costs, we only have so much fresh water. And the cost of producing and pumping that water is very expensive, and the demand increases. We're going to increase in price, and we got to figure out how to get water. I mean, there's only so much fresh water around, and we have to start thinking of technological solutions like recycling water, which I was speaking to someone about Singapore, and Singapore now recycles 30% of their water. So things that go down the toilet come right back into the system, and it's clean and it's good, and that's what we're going to all be used to. And I think in California there's already some recycling in the, I think it's in the Orange County area. So it's not just around the world, it's here in our own country. By 2030, the world's population will increase by 1 billion in consuming 40% more energy and 50% more water. We're consuming more and more and more of these resources, and it's getting really scary. You know how today we think of the Iraq war and some of the wars are fought over oil? Well, already there have been wars that are fought over water. In fact, I think I was reading an article in the New York Times. The instigator of the Syrian crisis started by a water problem in the Syrian country. If you look at Palestine and Israel, it's all about the water. If you look at Singapore as a country, as a young country, its security is all based on water. It gets a good portion of its water from Malaysia, but also desalination. But you know, the government put a lot of emphasis and money into the whole water infrastructure. It's one of the most advanced water utilities in the world because of security. This is what our future is going to be, and this is what you guys have to help us solve. And the increased demand is deteriorating our infrastructure. So if you look at that pipe, these are the pipes that our water is coming through now. Some of this infrastructure has been around for 50 years, for 100 years. And if you go to a place like Cary, which is a pretty new city, you know, they have pretty new pipes. But Raleigh's been around for a while. If you look at the older eastern, northeast states, I mean, some of that infrastructure has been around for, you know, like a century. And it's dying out, and I'm sure you've heard of cases where you have glaciers of water spitting out of a pipe where it busts. These just could happen in any place, anywhere, and it's very difficult to predict those things. And what we need is technology to predict it, and that to me is so exciting. It's just very exciting. So that brought me to Census. And I'd just like to share with you this story again. So I've been now doing handbags, and prior to that I was in academic research, and prior to that I was in industry. And I read this white paper, and I get really, really passionate about water and global resources, and I want to be a part of that. Well, I find a local company called Census. It's headquartered right here in Raleigh. It's been around for 140 years. And I applied for a job. Well, of course, I don't have any utility experience. I don't know anything about this whole new industry. But I did tell them that I drink water, and I love the taste of it, and I love to go swimming in it, and I like to turn on the faucet, turn off the faucet, and watch that whole process. That was it. That's all I could relate to, water. Otherwise, they were looking for people that had real experience in utility. And this one's for the director of technology. So it's a, you know, well, my job right now is really to look at the future of technologies and how we can incorporate them in our products. So it wasn't a very light job. It was a serious job, and I had no experience. So I had my first interview. That's because I stalked them and I bothered them until they interviewed me. So finally, they gave me an interview. I went in, I loved everything I was hearing, and I really, really wanted to be a part of this. And so what did I do? I left that interview place, and I acted as if I had the job. So I actually started doing research on all the technologies that they're working on, and started looking at, you know, they do meter technology, so they measure the flow that comes to your house, they measure the flow for industry, but they're also technology solutions. So I started looking at the batteries because, you know, these meters that go on your house have to last for about 20 years. And so the key part of that is the battery. So I started looking at battery technology. There's a lot of research online. You know, you can get all these scholarly papers online, and sent a few of them with some summary to the guy that I interviewed with. He's like, what's this girl doing? She doesn't even have a job. She's already doing this. I researched transceivers because Census is all into their own communication system. So I did some research on that, and I sent him over. I I did all kinds of research on water quality sensors, all types of sensor technology, all the things that they currently do. I went ahead and did it. Why? Because one, I am really excited about it, and two, I really want to get this job, and I want to show them that I could do it, even though they haven't made a promise. And sometimes, that's the best way to get a job if you don't have the experience that they're looking for, and I definitely did not. So anyway, now I'm there, and I just want to share with you some of the technologies and some of the engineering this whole industry has, because this was all new to me starting last June. The utility distribution and technology, so it senses we work at both the electric smart grid, the water smart grid, and the gas smart grid. We're in all three, but water is really where we feel the biggest opportunity because we're sort of leaders in water. We have the most accurate technology for metrology, like how we measure the down to the 0.01 gallons versus some of the other ones. We have one of the best communications. We have a licensed radio, and some of the people that I've been meeting that works at Census is just amazing. So there is communications technology, there are these utilities. Imagine water going through these utilities. You have to, is anyone in here from civil engineering? Any civil engineers? Oh, a couple. So, I mean, you've learned a little bit about the hydraulic modeling for the water flow. I mean, that's really, really important. And, you know, if we want to get technology that can control these at one point, I look at the utility industry as an industry that's kind of been staying still for decades and decades. And only in the last decade has it started getting into technology. And right now, imagine these water utilities, which are first treating the water, which is a very expensive process, then pumping the water, which is another very expensive process, and then distributing the water. And meanwhile, out of all that expense to treat and pump, in some cases, 53% of that water is lost, is leaked out, falls out. So you spend all this money and time and effort treating and pumping, and then it flows away in a leak. And that's like wasting so much money. I mean, there is so much money to be saved if we can help utilities find these leaks. And in order to find those leaks, we need to get more sensors all across the whole distribution. We need to sense the pressure. We need to sense the flow. We need to sense the water quality. We need to sense the chlorine values. We need to do all of that sensing, and then we need to understand how water actually flows through the pipe, and that's where the hydraulic model comes in. And how do we collect that data and simulate the movement of that data so that we can provide them the answer to determine when and where the next leak may be so that they can save some money. So distribution technology is very exciting. And like I said, even communications. You know, most of these sensors are going to be battery operated. Some are going to be power operated. But getting that communication, that's a pretty hard job. And some people are going to cellular, but even cellular cannot reach some of these locations to get some of these sensors. So, you know, working in communications at a company, you know, in the utility business is fascinating. There's a lot of advanced technologies going into how do we communicate and collect data, and then what kind of data do we want to pass over, and how large is the payload that we can, you know, prevent as many collisions as possible to get as much data as possible. So there's a lot of very exciting communications technology going on. Sensor technology, this is one of my favorite areas. I was talking to one of the professors at State, and we're going to start a collaboration on sensor technology because you've heard what happened, it was about 2 months ago in, was it Charleston, Virginia or something? Charlotte, Virginia?
Charleston, where, West Virginia.
Where is it?
Charleston, West Virginia.
Yeah, West Virginia, sorry. And they had that big chemical dump, and everyone, I mean, one of the biggest no-nos in water utilities is when you tell your customers you have to boil water. So that was a very scary thing, and it took a long time to flush all those chemicals out, and it took a long time before they even realized the chemicals were in the distribution. So again, this is where sensor technology is extremely important. If you had sensors all along there, you could have detected it quicker, you could have put a stop, you could have closed the valve so it doesn't, you know, disrupt the rest of the distribution. There's a lot of technology that doesn't even exist yet. Data analytics, one of the big areas in almost any industry. It's one of the most exciting areas. I love and I'm very excited about data analytics. And it's really as simple as collecting all kinds of data, and we're talking about lots of data. So imagine your meter at the end of the house, whether it's an electric or a gas or a water meter, used to collect once a month just to provide a bill. Well, no more. I mean, we're collecting data on your water uses, your electric uses, your gas uses on 15-minute buckets. We can get even less. We can get to a second if we wanted to. And really understand what's going on inside your house and understand how much water you end up using when you take a shower. And then when demand goes up, the price goes up. So in the near future, these prices are going to be the pricing of the electric power that you use or the water that you use will be different at different times so that you can have a steady demand. So you might want to run your dishwasher in the middle of the night when you're sleeping. Yes?
California already bills that way. So depending on different times of day, you get, and different times of the year, you can get different charges, like peak demand charges, because it's already being used at so much at a certain time.
So then the consumer will end up, based on the price, will probably end up changing the way they do things. So if in California they're charging at 7 o'clock in the evening, you know, a lot of money for power and for water, you might say, well, you know, I could run the washing machine or the dishwasher later or take your showers at different times. So it really changes human behavior, which goes back to data analytics. You know, there's this whole home networking aspect of it. I mean, it's incredibly exciting. I just cannot say enough about data analytics and how it's going to fill into every part of the world, every part of our environment as well. I like to look at these distribution systems. If you think about the human body and you think about how blood gets pumped at different times, you know, when you're going up a hill, you know, your heart starts to pump more so it can bring blood to all the different places and go to your fingertips. I like to think of that like a distribution system. And today we have very static ways of pumping water and distributing water. And if we put sensor technologies in all the key places and we start collecting data, imagine becoming more efficient. So only pumping water when we need water, when the demand asks for it. And it starts to behave more like the perfect human body that we have, you know, how our system really works. I mean, if you really think about it, we have electricity going through our body. We have, you know, water through our bloodstream going through our body. And it's very efficient. Everything relies on the other thing. And that's where we're heading. So we're starting off way out here, and we can get to the point where it's way, way, way more efficient with technology. So it's a pretty exciting area. And, you know, we talk about, some people say smart cities. We like to use the term connected cities because with our radio technology, we can actually connect machine to machine everywhere. So one of the other areas we're getting into is lighting. And lighting can also be controlled. So imagine if all of a sudden everyone's going to a Duke football game, then the lights will automatically come on all around there. So it'd be nice and safe and people will feel comfortable. If it's a Friday or a Saturday evening and everyone's out in the streets, we can actually go from this light to LED light, which almost makes it feel like daylight. We have our lights in a city called Chattanooga, Tennessee, and they actually found business increased in the evening by 17% because of the lighting, just because it was brighter, people felt more safe and more comfortable. So imagine all of these things interacting, you know, the water distribution. Imagine also you're collecting data on traffic. And the traffic is sort of all heading in one area because there's going to be a football or a basketball game. And then there's going to be some flushing of the commodes and drinking water. And so now your demand on water is going to be predictive. You're going to know when you're going to need this much water. You're going to know when you need this much electricity because you're seeing traffic patterns, for example. So we're getting there where the cities are all interconnected. The lights come on when we need them, come on and go off when we need them, dim when we need them. I mean, it's just... Okay. And the other thing, I was recently invited, there was a really nice conference here at the UMSTED by Duke University, NC State University, and SAS Institute, and it was called the Global Engineering Challenges. And we had the president of the American Academy of Engineers come and speak, and he just got back from, I think it was London, where they had the Global Engineering Academy meeting. And they came up for this year with the 14 grandest challenges for engineering. And if you read through them, they're really exciting. But two of them, you know, provide access to clean water and restore and improve urban infrastructure, are two of the big 14 grand challenges. So I think this is really the conclusion of my talk, and what I really wanted to say is that, you know, having engineering as a foundation is really exciting. I think careers can go in all different directions. You know, follow your passions. There's just so much excitement out there, and always take risks. So I think that's it. So thank you so much.